Higher Life in Christ, sponsored by Brother Leo Quadros.
Your life as it is today is the image of what you created years ago. And your life in the next few years, the future, is what you create now with your words. See how important this is. You know, there are people who don't have much expectation in life. They were never raised to have much expectation. They were never brought up to have much expectation. Life was always a competition of some kind at home or wherever in their environment. There's always this struggle, you know. They had to struggle. And they even believe that life is a struggle. Say, I know how I've been struggling. I know. Your life is going to continue as a struggle. Even though you're born again and you're full of the Holy Ghost, you'll still be struggling. Because it's the path that you have chosen with your words. See, what does the salvation that Jesus Christ brought to us, what does it mean to you? The Bible says those who have entered into his rest have ceased from their struggles. Why are you still struggling? They have ceased from their struggles. We're dealing with the integrity of the word. What does the word mean? Does it mean what it says? Romans chapter 5, verse 17. Let's read it. Romans chapter 5, verse 17. Does God's word mean what it says? For if by one man's offense death reigned by one, much more they which receive abundance of grace and of the gift of righteousness shall reign in life by one, Jesus Christ. What does this mean? Does it mean anything? Look at it. This is very powerful. For if by one man's offense, Adam's offense, death reigned because of Adam's transgression, death came into the world. Okay? So, he says, death reigned by one. Much more than death reigned. They which receive abundance of grace. Who are they? Us. The Bible says the law came by Moses, but grace and truth came by Jesus Christ. They which receive abundance of grace and of the gift of righteousness. He's given us the gift of righteousness shall reign in life. They shall reign in life, not struggle in life. Shall reign in life. Let's have the Amplified. Okay, now it gets a little better. He says, those who receive the free gift of righteousness, putting them into right standing with himself, reign. See, they shall reign as kings in life. All right? They shall reign as kings in life. So he does stretch it a little for you to see. So are you reigning as a king? How do kings reign? With words. With words. You influence your life and the circumstances of your life with words. Such that no matter what happens around you, no matter what comes out against you, no matter the crisis you face, you are always on top. That's the life that Christ has given us. We have no reason to complain or to feel dejected or be discouraged? No, because we are kings. We are kings in life. Revelation, book of Revelation, chapter 1. Let's read from verse 4 into verse 5. John, to the seven churches which are in Asia, grace be unto you and peace from him which is and which was and which is to come, and from the seven spirits which are before his throne. Mm-hmm. and from Jesus Christ, who is the faithful witness and the first begotten of the dead and the prince of the kings of the earth. Hallelujah. Glory to God. I love that address. Unto him that loved us and washed us from our sins in his own blood. Read the next line. And hath. That's the past tense. He's not trying to do it. He's not hoping to do it. He's not planning on doing it. And hath made us kings and priests unto God and his Father. To him be glory and dominion forever and ever. And everybody said amen.
Amen.
And hath made us kings. It's not a promise. It's a statement of fact. A present hour reality. He hath made us kings. Now, you know, if you're new to something like this, you never heard this kind of teaching in your life, and you're sitting and listening to me, you're just wondering, what in the world is he saying? What is he saying? Didn't you hear what we called it when we preached the message to you? We called it gospel. You know the meaning of gospel? Good news. Do you know what it is for God to send you good news? It's got to be really good. For God to describe it as good news, it's got to be pretty good.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
And hath made us kings and priests unto God and his Father. He's made us kings. He didn't say when we get to heaven. That's past tense. He's done it. This is the way God sees us. Because we are kings. Hallelujah. That's why God doesn't ever want you to be selfish. You don't have a need to be selfish. You are too rich to be selfish. But he says, so if this thing is true, why am I like this? That is the subject, the integrity of the word. Does the word mean what it says? That's the question. Let me show you something. Ephesians chapter 2, we'll read from verse number 4. Ephesians chapter 2. But God, who is rich in mercy, for his great love wherewith he loved us, even when we were dead in sins, hath quickened us together with Christ. Quickened. The word translated quickened means made us alive. He's made us alive together with Christ. You know what he's saying? You know, when Jesus died on the cross, in the mind of justice, in the mind of God, we were in him. When he was dying, we were dying. All right? Not just us Christians. No, the whole world was dying. Everybody was in Christ because he died for the whole world. The salvation was for everybody. Whether you're Christian or non-Christian, the salvation of Jesus Christ was for everybody. So when he was dying on the cross, man was dying on the cross. You get it? And when he was buried, man was buried. And when God raised him up, everybody was raised up in Christ. So he told us, go tell everybody. And once you hear it and believe it, you are awakened to the reality of this life. The life which he gives as the gift becomes vital reality in your spirit. But legally, everyone is saved. Everybody. Because Jesus paid for everybody. That's what he told us to tell them. All right, go back to where we were. Ephesians chapter 2 and verse 4. But God, who is rich in mercy, for his great love wherewith he loved us, even when we were dead in sins, even when we were dead, I just read it to you. He reconciled us to himself without counting our sins against us. Even when we were dead, he loved us, even when we were dead in sins, hath quickened us together with Christ, made us alive together with Christ. By grace ye are saved. Hallelujah. Next verse. And hath raised us up together. You see, when he was crucified, we were crucified together. You get it?
All right.
And hath raised us up together and made us sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. He's made us sit together. So where is our seat of authority? Oh, let me help you to understand. See, the throne is not a chair. The throne is power, authority. For example, imagine the Oba of Lagos. Okay? He's the Oba of Lagos. He's got some authority. When he travels to Kano State, does he cease to be the Oba of Lagos? Does he have to carry his chair so that they will know he's the Oba of Lagos? He doesn't have to carry his chair. When the Queen of England travels to another country, she doesn't have to carry her chair. Her throne is not the chair. You get it? So even though you are sitting here, your real seat of authority is in heaven. And had raised us up together. When he was raised from the dead, we were raised together with him. And made to sit together in heavenly places in Christ. There is where our authority is coming from. So when I say thus and thus in the name of Jesus, it's a word spoken from heaven. Hallelujah. And what happens is angels go out to effect it. They go out to effect it. When we give the word, they go out to effect it. Hebrews chapter 1. Let's read from verse 13 into 14. Hebrews chapter 1 from verse 13. But to which of the angels said he at any time, sit on my right hand until I make thine enemies thy footstool? He's talking about angels now. Then it says in verse 14, are they not all, are these angels not all ministering spirits sent forth to minister for them who shall be heirs of salvation? Talking about us. He sent the angels to minister for them, not to them, but for them. Do you understand what that means? That means they come to do what we want done. They're not doing to us, doing for us. The ministering for us. Because we are kings. Hallelujah. That's why God doesn't ever want you to be selfish. You don't have a need to be selfish. You are too rich to be selfish. But he says, oh, if this thing is true, why am I like this? That is the subject, the integrity of the word. Does the word mean what it says?
The Bible says in Hebrews chapter 10, verse 25, not forsaking the assembling of ourselves together, as the manner of some is, but exhorting one another. Be inspired in this segment as Pastor Chris teaches on the importance of participating in services.
You know what has happened to a lot of Christians? Somewhere along in their life, they were building their faith. Then somewhere, they just stopped building their faith. They started looking at circumstances. Their faith didn't grow more. So you have people who are Christians 25 years, but their faith is like the faith of a three-year-old. Someone is just starting, who's got no knowledge of the word. And then they wonder why they don't have the results. How can you have the result if you don't build your spirit strong? You have to build your spirit, become seasoned in the word, understand what the word says, and walk in the light of it. See, God doesn't want you, you know, stumbling into miracles, stumbling, you know, you do something, it works. Then you say, wow, wow, wow. Then the next time you do it, it doesn't work. Well, why does it happen like that? Because you don't understand the principles. You just stumbled into it. It worked. The next time it didn't work, because you don't understand the principles. But once you understand the principles, you know what to do. You're in control. You're in charge. You become the adopted son. That means the heothesia. That means the son that has been trained and brought to office. Now you can handle stuff. See, if you have a very rich shop and you sell a lot of goods, you don't just put your son there because he's your son. You got to train him in the art. Otherwise, he'll lose everything. He'll lose the business. So you train him. He doesn't know it because he's old. You say, my son is old enough. He should be able to. No, they don't know it because they're old enough. He'll lose the business, as many have lost the business. He has to be trained in the art. He has to be trained. Same thing with you. So take the house of God seriously. We'll talk about Sunday service, Wednesday service. The term service is a misnomer, okay? So don't be misled by that. But it's the generic terminology, and we're all used to it. And since it doesn't harm anybody, it's fine. So we'll say we're going for church service. You ask, what service are you really rendering when you get there? Okay? But it's fine. I'm not trying to change that one. But the point of that is, when we go to the house of God, there's a lot for us to gain. See? There's a lot for us to gain. There's so much that the Spirit of God plans for us, for our spirits. And we become strengthened, refreshed, built up, ready to face the world. What you hear in the house of God, where the Spirit of God ministers to you in the house of God, you don't get that stuff anywhere else. The house of the Lord is built for it. When we come together as God's children. So you grow your faith strong. Grow your faith strong. All right? I always tell people, one of the things that I'm so grateful to God for is that I started early in my life. I started early. Because sometimes I wonder, you know, a lot of folks who come in when they're already old, I wonder, where are you going to start from? You've got to be in a hurry. You've got to eat the word of God voraciously. You should come very early for service. Don't come late. Because you already entered the kingdom late. You know? So everything now, I mean, you got to get every stuff. Yeah. Because it says, train up a child in the way he should go. When he's old, he will not depart from it. Train up a child. It didn't say train up a man. So you catch it early in your life. But if you came in late, my goodness, you need more than double of this thing. You need to buy all the messages, the DVDs, whatever, you know, all the downloadables. Get all of them. Get the stuff. Morning, noon, and night. Make sure you're plugged into the messages. You need extra time to catch up. Extra time. Because the Bible says, let the word of Christ dwell in you in abundance, richly, in all wisdom and spiritual understanding. This is your life. Hallelujah. Yeah.